Hello again. Glad you've tuned in. You've obviously heard there's a football match on tonight. England against Germany, the second semi-final of Euro 96. Sporting history waiting to be made.
In everyone's life, there are moments when you look back and think,
bad place. He looks as if he's got here. He must have assembled a decent team in Euro 96. I think that's why he made all his money off the back of us players, actually. Oh, there's the man there, look, there he is.
Hey!
Hey.
How you doing?
Well, you haven't got a bad place here, have you?
It's not bad. Hey? It's all right. It's all right.
You've done something right in your life. How
well,
are you?
I don't know about that.
Great nice to see you. Yeah, thank you very too. Much. Thanks
great,
for having us.
Great to come.
You want to show us around?
Of course.
So, how long have you been here?
18 years. Opened a year, actually open.
How did you find this spot, then?
Well, it was because I was we were looking for something else and bumped into this.
Yeah. La Escondida.
La Escondida.
What does, what does that mean?
Hideaway.
Hideaway. Hideaway. Retreat, is that something
retreat.
Like that?
Retreat, yeah, you've got it, yeah. Keeps you
busy,
going
then,
out
yeah.
of trouble. And
absolutely.
Hopefully, anyway. This is the reception where everyone comes in and gets checked in with their passports and...
And a lovely glass of champagne
glass,
on arrival.
Glass of
nice.
Champagne on arrival. Then we go through here, the chefs, there are four chefs.
Good afternoon.
Okay.
Wow.
So,
where did it all go wrong?
Yeah, no, it's a lovely, lovely view. Let's have a little wander around. I don't even know where I am. I've only just got up.
Euro 96 will be a landmark event in our sporting history, just as the World Cup finals were 30 years ago.
Let's go then. Just going to take some money off you.
Now, group three. England!
So you were at West Ham with Sam and then Stevenage, and whatever happened, happened. Are you looking to get back into football?
Well, if you'd have asked me 4 or 5 days straight after getting the sack, I'd have gone, sod that, what a game that is.
Did you always think you were going to go into management? Because I always thought you were happy on the golf course.
I feel like I'm a football man. Yeah. You know, that's all I ever wanted to do when I was a kid growing up. I felt it was the right
you
time.
You played
to go.
Under some decent managers, didn't you? Clough,
yeah.
Venables, Fergie.
Yeah.
What did you take off those guys?
Obviously not enough.
Ah, look at the old fella, look straight up the middle.
It's ugly, but I'll take it.
At the start of the European Championship, only 16 days away now, team spirit and match fitness for some of his players is what he wants from this two-game tour to the Far East.
Hello. You all right?
Good to see you.
Nice to see you.
Hello.
How are you?
Lovely you all right? To see you. You all right?
I'm very well, thanks. Good. Thanks very much for doing this.
It's a pleasure.
We don't remember anything.
Well, I don't
know. It's a very long time ago.
We've even got the old sofa for you boys.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you recognise it?
It's like the old
lovely.
Nice. Should we sit on it?
I think that's we can sit on it.
Are you sit here, don't you know?
Hello and welcome to European Fantasy Football League.
What are you guys up to now?
I mainly beg on the street. lots of stuff. We do still. He lives in my road, by the way. I think people think.
Oh, right. Still,
because we
up
don't.
Here.
Yeah, we don't do a show together.
That right. we now haven't. That we have families, we thought maybe we shouldn't be in the same house. Otherwise, it becomes a commune.
Yeah.
In the Czech Republic game last Sunday, John Motson was particularly critical of the two strikers substituted by Germany.
So Bierhoff's got a short time to press his claims. Now that the two other strikers who started the match have both been taken off. Kuntz.
Fantasy football, how did that come about? Whose idea was that? Because we've got the sofa there as well, the same sofa.
Yeah, no, this is the
we're
sofa.
Sitting in the right order as well. Right this is how we always
I have to say the sofa has actually aged better than the three of us, hasn't it?
Yeah, it certainly has, yeah. It hasn't gained a pound.
We got phoned up by the bloke who brought the actual game to Britain, and he said, could this be on the telly? And we talked about it, and we thought, well, it could, but as long as basically it's a comedy show about football. Yeah. He said, why don't we just make it a representation of our own home life, where we sit on the sofa, we watch football
beer.
With beers. He's an ex-alcoholic, so he wasn't actually drinking any beer.
You're never an ex-alcoholic.
Sorry.
Yes.
But, I would drink beer, and then the people would come round and watch football with us.
I think in the 90s, we were seen as being at the centre of a thing called the New Lads culture. Mm. People get nostalgic about Euro 96, but not New Lads. Now, it's really disgraced, just because the magazines had pictures of Liz Hurley in her underwear.
Two of Britain's most popular pop groups have begun the biggest chart war in 30 years. I'm a fire starter, twisted fire starter.
Pop group Take That have confirmed they're to split up.
Damien Hirst has won this year's Turner Prize.
England have named their squad for the European Championship finals, which kick off at Wembley in 12 days' time.
Would fantasy football work now?
I think the show could exist. I mean, you know, the show...
There's... Could you get away with now with what you did then?
Well, there were some things. Like, there was a player who played for Notts Forest called Jason Lee. Jason Lee was missing goals consistently, and we featured all his misses in, like, you know, montages.
All his misses?
They make me sick!
Yeah, they make me sick!
Pineapple head, was it the pineapple
head? Yeah. I mean, we wouldn't be able to get away with that, and maybe that's a good thing.
But basically, what we did do is we said on telly what people said on the terraces and stuff all the time.
Oh, so how are you? Nice to see you. Exactly. Yeah, good. Good, yeah. Nice to see you. Good.
So what's life like now then as a hotel owner? Stressful, is it? What is it?
It's stressful in as much as it's hard work.
Can't be that hard work. You look unbelievable for your age. You're doing something
steady,
like that.
Steady, steady.
What would you be doing if you weren't going to be playing football all your life?
Oh, I have no idea. That's all I can do.
Do you miss football?
Yeah, of course. Hey. I mean, how can you not? I mean, it's my life. It's always been my life, and it always will be until there is no.
Now, inside. You're still in contact.
Imagine if we had won that tournament. It would have been Sir Terry Venables.
Oh, God.
Do you look back at the tournament and think it's a tournament we should have won?
I just don't know how we didn't win it. What we went through was something I've never experienced.
One of the best times of your life?
Oh, without a doubt. Yeah. I think the best.
The best?
Yeah, I would say.
Even after what you've achieved at Barcelona and Tottenham and everywhere you've been?
Well, yeah, it was a good career, going from Crystal Palace with Queen's Park Rangers and getting higher and better. Yeah. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, I thought someone was having a joke, you know, that Barcelona's very interested. Yeah. But then when you get to England, it's always to do with your parents and your grandparents and special feeling.
Proud moments, then?
I think proud moments is right, yes.
In 96, I was in the form of my life for Blackburn. I'd won the league the season before, but I hadn't scored for England for nearly 2 years. On top of that, Terry Venables had been forced to announce he would step down after Euro 96. We were all feeling the pressure of a competition on home soil.
Within the last few minutes, police have confirmed that they're investigating allegations of damage to the plane that carried the England players back from Hong Kong.
The police, the Football Association and the airline are all investigating the incident, which has prompted calls from some MPs to exclude any players involved from the team.
Take you back to our little infamous trip to China and Hong Kong. Did you feel that the players let you down because of that episode in that particular nightclub? No. Was that... Because you'd give us a curfew. There was seven or eight players.
There were seven or eight
pictured,
stayed back in the hotel.
There was probably four or five that were out who weren't pictured also, and I was one of those guys. Did you ever feel that we let you down by actually going out and breaking the curfew?
Those are the things that make the difference, because you think you're in trouble, and all of a sudden you've actually said, no, my job here and your job with me is to win the game.
Yeah.
However we win it, we win it.
So you used that. You used the negative press to your advantage.
Well, even some of the FA people were very unhappy with me. and I'm saying, well, fine. We'll talk about it later.
The England squad has accepted collective responsibility for what happened.
Did you feel we let him down in what we did in Hong Kong, or what you did? You were the ringleader. You were the one with your top off in the dentist chair.
I'm never the ringleader.
I'm always there, but I'm never the ringleader.
The guy who says he had his top off in the chair and everything, yeah.
I was exactly the same at school. I was easily led, you know, and I'm still the same even now.
The thing was, they had permission to go out drinking, and that is a fact. There were some supporters there taking some photos, knowing that, oh, there's the boys, you know. Yeah. And then there was the problem that it sort of sparked off. Yeah. Well, that's life.
It's a great night, isn't it? It's a great night. You know, with all the shirts, all ripped shirts, I don't think it ever got out how that came about. I remember Brian Robson coming over to us and went, "Oi, be careful, lads." Someone came out from behind whoever he was talking to and went, "Shut up, Robbo," and pulled the top down and ripped his top like that. And he just sort of looked and went, "Oh."
And he was the coach.
And he was the coach. And then that escalated into a few others, and then all hell broke loose. And a couple more drinks, we looked a right shambles, didn't we?
And now you know why we never won the tournament.
So to the first match, England against Switzerland in Group A. Wembley packed to the rafters, the atmosphere electric, the commentary from Barry Davis.
The long wait is over. This is for real.
Well, thanks very much, guys. You're both still commentating. How are you both? All well?
I think so, yes. Yeah. Voice is still fairly strong, and I think his is too.
We survive. We always have.
Yeah.
The wider media wrote us off, I think. Mm. So what were your opinions when you saw what happened or what went on?
As you said, you got hammered in more ways than one.
Yeah.
How long did it take you to think that
not
one?
Not very long. So it wasn't a favourable press, not when we went into the first game.
A new generation think that it's all about to begin, and it is now.
I wanted to take you to golf, you wanted to take me fishing, so we've done neither. We've come for a romantic stroll in the park. This is more your scene, isn't it? Cool and calm, and you'd never been into Manners, weren't you? You're one of the few of the squad that didn't.
Just never fancied it.
Is that what's taking most of your time about, a bit of fishing or a bit of golf, or what is it?
I love my fishing. You know, golf, I play off six, so I play a bit of golf, and we still ice skate.
As you do.
Turco Matt's in the 6-yard area.
We were all under pressure, and it wasn't the greatest of performances, was it?
No, it wasn't. And I do remember feeling the pressure a lot because of the fact that it's at Wembley and then all the stuff that had gone in the press.
Ah, dear, here you go. Another wonderful morning at Escondida.
I hadn't scored for almost 2 years, nearly 14 or 15 games leading up. I remember it well as well.
I was saying, take it easy. You've got to take it easy.
Panicking, yeah. For God's sake, hurry up and score. But what you said to me was, whatever happens in between now and Euro 96 starting, Alan, you will be my number nine. You will start that first game. And I stood back from that and I thought, wow, for him to tell me that, he didn't half think a lot of me.
It wasn't really a difficult decision for me. You just think, well, you're no good putting worry onto worry.
How did you feel?
You beauty!
They're holding up the lights on the board, and it's Paul Gascoigne.
You're hoping to play well, just to shut everybody up.
You know, we didn't play that well, though,
no,
did we?
I know, and that was another penalty as well.
Yeah.
Grazie, blocked by the hands of Pearce, and that is a penalty. It's going to be down to David Seaman to save the day. A terrible mass to take. And it's 1-1. Roll it in.
That really didn't calm everyone down.
But everybody made comparisons with 30 years before.
Yeah, Uruguay.
And I'll tell you what, England-Switzerland was a great deal better than England-Uruguay, which was a terrible game.
And the European Championship opens with a draw.
We're going to get 3 points against Scotland and then try and get something against Holland as well, to be sure of getting through, so it's going to be tough. You're going to have to play better than that.
A little bit disappointed, but look forward to the Scotland game. We've got a week to prepare for it.
But don't write us off.
I just don't know whether we expect too much from the manager and the quality of players that we have.
The fans have a right to kind of expect England to beat Switzerland at Wembley.
Inventive, creative, on the ball, he's England's best player. An open play, if anybody's going to make it happen, is going to be Paul Gascoigne. But after 50 minutes, he disappeared, and England as an attacking force disappeared as well.
We're on our way to see Gazza. He's doing a Q&A in Newcastle. He does 20 or 30 a year now, which is great for him. He's got to have an income. People, I think, have badly advised him, took advantage of him, because he's such a genuine and open and honest guy. His dream was to be a footballer. It was like mine. He was fortunate enough to make it as a footballer because of his talent. He's left here the North East and went down to London, which many say was the downfall of him. If he had gone to Manchester with Fergie, then it might have been slightly different, and I probably agree with that. I know he's had a bit of a tough time over the last few years. When you look at some people, you're hoping the penny might drop. And I hope daily, and I pray daily, that I don't wake up hear that the worst has happened to Gazza, because the world would be a sadder place without him.
Did you miss football?
Oh, badly.
Because you loved it, didn't you?
Definitely. I really miss it badly. Even today, I just still wished I was playing. I find it really hard to sometimes watch
but
games.
But you're good, though. You're good? You're looking good?
Yeah, not too bad. Yeah. It took us 20 years, but...
What's your memories of Hong Kong? Just before 97.
I remember. And all I know is I went on some chair for a filling. My tooth was slack at the back.
The dentist chair.
Yeah, the dentist chair. Obviously, it was my birthday as well that time, and I know that. So I'm talking about celebrating your birthday.
Terry Venables, happy to face autograph hunters. A welcome change from fending off a week of constant questions, yet again on fitness, nightclubs and alcohol.
The public pick up the paper and they're going to believe all they're reading, that and we're made out to have had a three-week party here.
Few beers, good weekend. Can't be it.
I think the Scots felt this was their great chance. They thought they could come to Wembley and really put up a show.
Paul Gascoigne is the talk of the town. What will you be saying to him before this match?
Well, I've already spoken to him. I just want him to relax and get his head around the game. I mean, he's been doing that all week.
You've always had a special bond with him, haven't you?
Yeah, he's just beyond anything you would expect from his football, from his cheek, from his audacity, from anything he could do. I mean, he was a brilliant player.
That night before the game in Scotland, it was 10 o'clock and I couldn't sleep, and I knocked on his door and he went, "What do you want?" Yeah. I went, "I'm worried." And he went, "Sit down." And I went, "Yeah." He said, "What are you worried about?" And I went, "I don't know if you're going to pick this or not." He said, "I'm not." Yeah. So I've got tears in my eyes, right? I'm saying, "Please, I promise I'll play well." Yeah. And he left the school for about 45 minutes, and now it's like 10:15. He went, "Of course you're playing, I'll get to bed and sleep."
I think it's a chance for this English team to show the nation that last Saturday was a one-off.
England have had their problems. Have they got together as a group and said, "Right, they've slated us, lads, let's go out and show them"?
We'd not played Scotland for ages, so it was, there was that pressure. Then there's the pressure that we actually needed to win.
Months of anticipation building up to this moment as Scotland in blue start the match.
It would have to be a fight. The second half was an excellent game against Scotland.
There was a point during the Scotland game where I did think, this is, surely we can beat Scotland.
Now McManaman, and a variety here by England. Gascoigne in the penalty area. This is Neville. Oh, and there's Alan Shearer! Alan Shearer scores for England. His second goal of the tournament. And England are in front.
Well, we win in 1-0, and then Tony Adam gives a penalty away.
And the cross fights Jury. Penalty! Penalty to Scotland.
Come on, was it you that saved the penalty, or was it Yuri Geller with the moving the ball and everything else?
I'm sure Yuri takes all the credit.
He repeated that
bit of absolute nonsense on fantasy football.
Anyway, the McAllister penalty.
That was mind power of millions of English people wanting it, you know, to distract.
He was in a helicopter, off the ground.
Yeah.
Is that what he said? Is that
he was making the ball move for England.
You don't think it might just be that Gary McAllister took a shit penalty?
As he ran up to the ball, I did see the ball just start rotating.
Did you see it move? Yeah.
Yeah, but then he must have seen it because he actually pinged it.
Yeah. Off we went down the wing, and then I remember about a minute later, Gazza scoring an unbelievable goal.
What did you think about Gazza's goal?
Yeah, it was a good one.
Special one. Yeah.
Thanks for stealing all my glory, though.
God.
It's Gascoigne. Oh, brilliant. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. What a wonderful goal by Gascoigne. What a pertinent answer to all his critics.
We loved all of you, but I think with Gazza we really felt like we'd got someone.
I remember us saying, whoever scores, lads, do the dentist chair. And, you know, being an alcoholic, that'd be me.
And is that your favourite goal?
Yeah, because we're at home, Euro 96, got loads of stick from the press, so that shut them up a little bit. But it was such a brilliant goal, I must admit.
Now, of course, the press turned. It was all about Gazza.
Sure, I mean, it set the tournament up from an England point of view, clearly.
This is the moment they'll talk about. When Gascoigne chinked through as of old and stamped his indelible mark on Euro 96.
The DJ put the song on at the end and suddenly, and we didn't know that everyone knew it, everyone starts singing it. And honestly, it's an unbelievable, unbelievable thing.
Whose idea was it?
Well, the song.
Who wrote the song?
The song music was written by Ian Brodie. Ian Brodie of the Lightning Seeds. He just felt that we represented football fans and so asked us to write the lyrics.
The weird thing was he was famous for writing bittersweet love songs and he said, I don't think I could write a football song. So we came in and we wrote a bittersweet love song about the England team.
Yeah, the lyrics were that thing of like trying to chime with the real experience of an England football fan, which is not that we're going to win, but nor that we think we're going to lose. It's somewhere in between. It's hope over experience. It's like, we're probably going to lose, but you never know, you never know. And that, I think, is what made it something that people have remembered and that people sung at the time.
It was always played on the bus, wasn't it, on the way to the games?
It's definitely the best football song, isn't it?
Yeah.
You're right. It got the nation together, didn't it?
When we took Three Lions to the England training camp and played it, we said, is there any players who'd like to come and be in the video? Now, to be in a pop video, you'd think that would be...
For most lads.
I remember you said, can't we just sign some footballs instead?
I was dull and I was boring. I actually watched it this morning and I was thinking to myself, I wonder how come I'm not in that video?
Because you were signing footballs, Alan.
We asked.
You didn't have any footballs to sign.
Yeah, we got Steve Stone instead.
Steve Stone.
You've been trying to look like him ever since.
I did the one, when Bobby Charlton fainted to go one way. Pushed it the other way and hit it in the top corner. I did it in the first take.
First
drilled it in the top corner.
It.
I was like, that'll do then. That's a take.
I must point out that we did actually come down to Burnham Beaches with the song and play it to you lot.
Yeah.
And I don't remember such a great reaction there.
Terry Venables listened to it, tapping his car keys like that along, and then he said, it's a real key tapper, isn't it? I said, I don't think that's a phrase, is it? A key tapper.
Yeah.
Well, as we stood probably half a mile away from Old Trafford, good memories for you, eh?
Oh, yeah, to play with so many great players in that great stadium. When I look at it, it brings back great memories.
Can you imagine how many more trophies you would have won if I had joined?
Well, I'm a bit disappointed. I'm a bit disappointed that you didn't join, mate.
But you can imagine the transfers you would have won.
I know, exactly.
What about your relationship with Gazza? Because both on the pitch and off the pitch, you got on very well with him, didn't you?
Yeah, we were very, very close. You know, he used to come to my room all the time. Yeah. You know, I know you're laughing.
Finals.
Play like that and maybe like that. And they didn't do any for it. All the three.
Yes, we've had a...
By that point, we knew that everyone was behind us. That semi...